If you permanently deform metal by bending or hammering it, it becomes stronger. This process, known as strain hardening, has been used for centuries to create everything from swords to car frames and even aerospace alloys. But did you know that the same process that strengthens swords and car frames also happens in your kitchen when you knead bread dough? Although you've probably never heard a word about it in any baking channels, strain hardening is a crucial factor in bread making. It explains why the gluten network actually gets stronger during kneading, allowing gas bubbles to inflate to a large volume during fermentation. But beyond that, we can also use strain hardening to explain why the dough gets stronger during resting. Later in the oven, as the gluten stretches again, it gets even stronger, resulting in a robust and airy crumb. Hi there, it's Seraphin, and today we're diving into a truly fascinating topic, the science behind why bread dough gets stronger when kneaded and rested. We all know about the importance of gluten in dough strength, but how does it actually work on a microscopic scale? We'll cover that, and we'll also go deeper into the mechanisms of how hydration can affect the dough's strength, as well as why it's really important to let your dough rest. By the end of this video, we'll use these new insights to re-examine the practical steps in our bread making process. Before we plunge in, I want to give a brief note on why we want to talk about this science at all. The truth is that if we look at it from an unbiased view, we love leavened bread so much that we're willing to endure the labor-intensive process of kneading, shaping, proofing, and baking. Even though when you think about it, making bread is actually a less efficient way to consume flour, especially when compared to simply boiling it, or even better yet, why make flour in the first place? Just boil the cereal grain by itself, as is done in many cultures. To add to that, the fact is that while yeast aerates bread, it does consume a small portion of nutrients during fermentation. However, we willingly accept this trade-off along with other inconveniences in exchange for the unique qualities of bread, such as its light, airy texture and satisfying flavor, with emphasis on that airy texture. From that perspective, we can see that understanding the science of strain hardening is a natural continuation of the bread making process, a way to make our bread even better. And this knowledge also allows us to fully enjoy the process of bread making by knowing what actually goes on in our bread dough. Naturally, to keep things focused in this video, we'll prioritize practical applications over technical jargon. In pursuit of clear and engaging explanations, we may occasionally simplify or generalize certain concepts. I'm entirely aware of the fact that there are clearly many other factors that might influence the final product, but in this video, our focus is on those that are related to strain hardening. With that said, while we will avoid overly complex explanations and formulas, we'll still delve into the nitty-gritty when necessary. So, with that out of the way, let's get to the heart of the matter: strain hardening. Like we said in the opening, strain hardening is essentially when a material gets stronger as it is permanently deformed, like through repeated stretching and resting. We are interested in how this happens in bread making, of course, but strain hardening as a phenomenon was recognized in other materials long before that. In 1885, a French civil engineer named Armand Considère first recognized its significance for metals in his seminal work on the use of iron and steel in construction. Considère's insights into the behavior of metal under stress were groundbreaking, particularly his observations on necking, a form of instability in metals closely related to strain hardening. Using simple calculus, he arrived at a simple equation to predict the onset of necking. This is a big deal for the construction of bridges, buildings, and many other structures. More than a century later, in 1992, Ton van Viet and his colleagues highlighted the importance of strain hardening in bread dough because it helps the dough hold on to gas, allowing it to expand during fermentation and baking. Due to strain hardening, the dough gets stronger as it is deformed or stretched by either external forces like kneading or internal forces like when the yeast produces gas. As the dough becomes stronger, it gets harder to deform it, which we can feel when we pull it. For more formal terms, these researchers define strain hardening as the phenomenon where the stress increases more than proportionally to the strain at constant strain rate and increasing strain. Putting aside other factors, gluten development primarily drives strain hardening in bread dough. Gluten's ability to strain harden and get stronger is crucial for the structure, texture, and flavor of bread. A dough with a higher strain hardening ability can better retain gas as mentioned, allowing the bread to achieve a desired bread volume, crumb structure, and density. I might add that even flavor could potentially be influenced by gas retention. Larger gas bubbles contribute to increased bread volume, while the distribution of gas bubbles affect crumb structure and density. These factors are fundamental to producing high-quality leavened bread, and strain hardening is evident throughout the bread-making process, particularly during kneading, fermentation, and baking. Now, in the decades since, research on strain hardening has continued to progress, and we've gotten a closer look at what's really going on at a microscopic level. Very recently, I came across a fascinating study on strain hardening. In a research paper published in Nature earlier this year, scientists at Harvard University were the first to observe strain hardening in real time using an electron microscope, allowing them to directly visualize the detailed mechanisms behind this process at the microscopic level. This is considered a breakthrough in our search for a better understanding of this phenomenon. Materials such as colloidal crystals or metals have imperfections in their atomic structure known as dislocations. When a material is permanently deformed, it brings about new dislocations. These dislocations interact and become tangled or pinned, hindering further movement. So as this resistant dislocation motion increases, the material's strength also increases, but its ductility decreases, which can eventually make it pretty brittle. This is strain hardening at its very core. It is ubiquitous, and yet, owing to the many ways dislocations can interact, our understanding of the mechanism that governs strain hardening is still incomplete. Naturally, though, bread is not made of colloidal crystals, and we unfortunately don't have a real-time study of strain hardening in bread dough. But this study is still pretty illuminating. While seemingly disparate, bread dough and colloidal crystals share a fundamental similarity. They are both structured systems where the arrangement and interactions of their components dictate their macroscopic properties. To make an analogy, in the study, they looked at colloidal crystals, while in bread dough, we look at gluten. Just as the study showed with colloidal crystals, at the microscopic level, the interactions of the gluten proteins are what result in strain hardening of the dough. That makes it become stronger as it goes through the bread-making process. But before we talk about how strain hardening works at the level of gluten proteins, we need to fully understand what strain hardening really does to the bread dough. Bread making involves three major stages: mixing, including kneading, fermentation, and baking. We can observe strain hardening at various points throughout these stages. It begins towards the end of the mixing stage, continues during fermentation, and peaks at the beginning of the baking stage. During mixing, as water is incorporated into the flour, it disperses the particles and acts as a plasticizer. This plasticization significantly reduces the glass transition temperature of the flour, transforming it from a rigid, glassy state to a more flexible, rubbery one. This transition is crucial for the development of the gluten network. Water also activates instant yeast and provides an optimal environment for sourdough microorganisms. Another important aspect of mixing is the incorporation of air into the dough. Tiny air bubbles, primarily filled with nitrogen, are introduced during mixing. These bubbles serve as essential nucleation sites for the formation of gas bubbles during fermentation, contributing to the dough's rise and the bread's final texture. Now, when we talk about strain hardening, it's actually a little too simple to say that strain hardening causes the dough to get stronger. It's not at all false, but the word strength is a little vague for our purposes right now, because a strong dough can mean quite a few things. Instead, let's focus on two key properties of the dough: elasticity and extensibility. We can explain the effect of strain hardening on bread dough by observing how these properties change. To illustrate this, we can draw a parallel with the stress-strain curve commonly used in material science. As we knead our dough up to a certain point, it exhibits elasticity, meaning it can return to its original shape after being stretched. Continued kneading eventually leads to the peak of this elastic stage. After sufficient rest, the dough can be stretched further, reaching its yield point, where it becomes more extensible. Extensibility enables the dough to hold new shapes, such as those created during pre-shaping, shaping, and proofing. Note, however, that elasticity shouldn't be confused with resistance to stretching. When you pull on a dough and it comes back to where it started from, that's elasticity. When you pull on a dough and find it difficult to stretch, that is resistance to stretching. Ultimately, the right combination of all these elements defines the strength and quality of the bread dough, allowing it to rise properly while maintaining its structure during shaping and baking. Exactly when the yield point and peak of elasticity happens can depend a lot on how much water is in the bread dough. Hydration refers to the ratio of water to flour in a dough, and it significantly influences the dough's behavior during kneading and shaping. For low hydration wheat dough, when making noodles, for example, going through the elasticity phase can be a long process that needs a lot of hard work, partly because it's just so difficult to mix everything together. And extensibility is often observed at the late stage of dough development, during sheeting before cutting. For wheat doughs with a regular hydration, say when we make shokupang, passing through the elasticity phase is a relatively easy task, and we can see extensibility during pre-shaping or shaping, a medium stage of dough development before proofing. And in high hydration wheat doughs, like with artisan bread, we can practically speed through the process of building the dough's elasticity and go right to the yield point where we can observe the dough's extensibility at a relatively early stage of dough development, such as during the stretch and fold technique that we often use. In this latter example, as we perform more stretch and folds, the dough's resistance to stretching increases. Like this. That is strain hardening. Again, this resistance is not elasticity. The dough's ability to bounce back to a certain extent remains the same as it was in the beginning, but it has become more resistant to being stretched, so you have to use more energy to pull it up. In almost all leavened breads, the dough undergoes similar phases of development, although the specific timing and techniques may vary depending on the type of bread and its desired characteristics. Anyway, throughout the process, the more we work the dough, the stronger it becomes. In fact, the gluten network not only becomes stronger when stretched, but it becomes stronger specifically in the direction in which it is stretched. However, like other materials that undergo strain hardening, it becomes less ductile as it gains strength. If we continue to work the dough beyond a certain point, it will eventually neck and rupture. To assess whether or not the dough is done when kneading or using stretch and folds, we often perform the so-called windowpane test. This test involves stretching a piece of dough into a thin film, which makes it a biaxial test because we're basically stretching the dough into two directions. A well-developed dough with a strong gluten network can be stretched significantly without tearing. In modern laboratories, dough is tested for its readiness in more scientific ways. Various instruments can be used to evaluate the strain hardening through stress and strain curves, and the results are compared to specific criteria. One such criterion is based on the Considère criterion for necking, which we mentioned earlier. State-of-the-art instrument can directly measure a parameter that is related to strain hardening, such as the strain hardening index of the Chopin alveograph. At the very core of all these tests, what we are really testing is the dough's strength in terms of extensibility. We test it because we want to be sure that during bulk fermentation and the oven spring, the dough can undergo further strain hardening as gas bubbles expand and stretch the dough films. If the dough rips, forget about strain hardening. A rip film wouldn't be able to get any stronger, which is why making sure that the dough has enough extensibility is very important, especially before we bake it. To sum it up, this ability to strain harden contributes to the development of the dough's structure and ultimately the quality of the final loaf. With this understanding of strain hardening at the level of the bread dough, we can now zoom in on what happens at the microscopic level. We'll get started by focusing on two of the main players in the dough structure, the gluten proteins and wheat starch. As we mentioned before, gluten proteins are what mainly drive the strain hardening of the dough. They are the components that allow the dough to get stronger when we knead it and let it rest or ferment.